Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. We've received apologies this morning from Brian Whittle, MSP. This morning we will continue our inquiry into the impact of the pandemic on the Scottish labour market, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting Susie Fitton, Policy Manager from Inclusion Scotland, who joins us remotely, and Pamela Smith, Head of Economy and Poverty at Public Health Scotland, who joins us in person, and Professor Sir Aziz Sheikh, Professor of Primary Care Research and Development and Director of the Usher Institute and Dean of Data at the University of Edinburgh, who joins us in person, and Jerry McCartney, who is a Professor of Wellbeing at the University of Glasgow. Thank you for all giving us your time this morning and for all your written submissions. We estimate that this session will run up to about 10:20, and each member should probably have about 15 minutes each to speak to the panel and to ask their questions. And for those witnesses who are attending remotely this morning, if you'd like to respond to any issues being discussed, if you could just type R in the chat box and we will try and bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witness in the interests of brevity. Could I please ask the witnesses to briefly introduce themselves? And I'll start with Susie Fitton, please.
And I'm a policy manager at Inclusion Scotland.
Thank you, Susie. Pamela Smith?
Good morning, committee. I'm Pamela Smith, and I'm Head of Economy, Poverty and Environment at Public Health Scotland.
Thank you. Professor Sir Aziz Sheikh?
Good morning, committee. So, Aziz Sheikh, I'm Professor of Primary Care Research and Development, Director of the Usher Institute and Dean of Data at the University of Edinburgh.
Thank you very much. And Jerry McCartney, please.
Good morning, committee. My name is Professor Jerry McCartney. I'm a Professor of Wellbeing Economy at the University of Glasgow.
Thank you very much. And we'll now turn to questions, if I may. If I can begin with Inclusion Scotland. Susie, if I could ask you a question, and thank you for the very detailed written submission that you provided to the committee. Moving on to long COVID, the committee has a keen interest to investigate this further, and I think the figures that you supplied in your report that nearly 4% of Scotland people in Scotland are currently living with long COVID, which is around 202,000, and 83,000 of those people have done so for more than 12 months, and 44,000 reporting that it affects their ability to undertake day-to-day activity. One of the things that I found quite worrying was the early studies suggested at least half of those with long COVID meet the diagnostic criteria of ME. And we know that ME is a profoundly debilitating neurological disease. It can affect multiple systems within the body. And prior to COVID, I think there were 21,000 people with ME in Scotland. Now, I note the substantial proportion of long COVID sufferers are experiencing similar illnesses, and this will have a direct impact on the ability, on people's ability to work. And I know that you feel that action is urgently needed to address this problem. Could I ask you, Susie, what would you like to see the government doing to address this problem?
So while some people with long COVID are able to return to work, particularly when their employers are supportive about making suitable adjustments to support them in the workplace. Many people with long COVID have been left in limbo in terms of getting the right advice and information and support to find out more about the symptoms that they're experiencing. And many disabled people and others have reported to us that they have not been receiving any support or advice and have either not been able to work at all or only with reduced hours. And it's a particular issue for people whose friends and family members are living with long COVID, and they've experienced challenges in combining unpaid caring roles with employment. particularly acute for parent carers of children and young people with long COVID, especially young people who are not able to attend school as a result of their symptoms. So we would argue that employers need support and advice about how to make reasonable adjustments to someone with long COVID. We would ask that employability support is made available to people with long COVID if they're forced to leave work, so that they can re-enter the labour force. In terms of the kind of things that are affecting people at work, in a recent survey by the TUC of over 3,000 workers with long COVID, 9 out of 10 respondents experience fatigue. There's problems with brain fog, shortness of breath, difficulty concentrating, and memory problems. And over 4 in 5 respondents reported experiencing at least one of a range of pain-related symptoms, with about 1/3 experiencing depression. So we would ask that similar measures that have been shown to support people with chronic illness and pain conditions are promoted to employers. And that's things like real flexibility in terms of the hours that people are allowed to work. So flexible working in the truest sense has been shown to support people with energy impairments back into work and allows them to maintain work. And we would argue that we would like to see flexible working. In this rush to get back to normality in terms of renewal and recovery from the pandemic, we're concerned that employers will be less likely to offer real flexibility. There's some concern that long COVID is not yet necessarily considered to be a disability, because it's not among the conditions listed in the Equality Act as ones which are automatically considered a disability, such as cancer, HIV, and multiple sclerosis. The Equality and Human Rights Commission, for example, originally said that not all cases, or they couldn't say that all cases of long COVID would fall under the definition of disability in the Equality Act. They've since qualified that to say that if it has a substantial and long-term adverse impact on someone's ability to do normal day-to-day activities, then it would count as a disability. But I think we need to ensure that workers affected by long COVID that employers follow existing guidance when considering reasonable adjustments for disabled people and access to flexible working.
Thank you, Susie. That's very helpful. If I could move on to start with the link between long-term sickness and economic inactivity. And Scotland tends to have a higher proportion of 16 to 64-year-olds who are inactive because of long-term sick when compared to the rest of the UK. And in Scotland, we've increased to 7%, which is compared to 5.4% of the rest of the UK. Firstly, my question is, why do the witnesses think Scotland is comparatively worse than the rest of the UK? And on an international scale, how do we explain the continued rise in the UK inactivity figures in comparison to the other OECD countries, which see the figures declining? Can I bring you in, Pamela?
Okay, thank you. In terms of the economic inactivity, I think the first point I would want to highlight is that some of the long-term health conditions and the chronic health conditions are preventable, and many people who are living with the chronic conditions are indeed supported to remain in work and remain economically active. So in terms of COVID affecting inactivity, I think it's still a pretty new condition in terms of the long-term effects. A bit more research is required there. But I think also when we're looking at chronic conditions and long-term sickness, we can't look at that in isolation. We know the intersectionality of disadvantage and inequality manifests itself in poorer health. And we know that it's estimated that a third of the individuals who have chronic conditions and long-term health could be supported to, you know, it could have been prevented basically through early intervention. So things like lack of good fair work that was referred to earlier, lack of access to skills and training for some parts of our community, and also the continued impact in terms of people living in poverty. So I think it's difficult to identify one reason because there's so many interdependencies and factors that impact on people's ability to move towards entering sustained employment, and health is one aspect to that. I think there's other reasons for the economic inactivity alongside health, and that may be around the labour market where they live. It may be around other caring responsibilities. So I think it's quite difficult to isolate that health may well be the only factor. I think we have to look at the individual and look at their individual circumstances. Health will be one factor, and it doesn't quite follow just by dealing with health alone that you will reduce the labour market inactivity or increase participation. We need to have a more holistic approach to the disadvantage and the inequalities that the individual is experiencing to get them into that sustainable labour market participation.
Thank you. And I know, Gerry, that you want to come in, but if I could just ask a quick question with it, the comparison between Scotland in relation to the rest of the UK, do you know specifically why it's so much higher in Scotland than the rest of the UK?
I don't have any evidence to hand that would indicate why there should be a difference.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And again, a lot of the studies are self-reported in terms of the cause for economic inactivity.
Okay, thank you. Gerry, you'd like to come in?
Thank you, Chair. So your question really was about, you know, why the trends were so bad and why Scotland was comparably bad. I guess I would like to bring to the attention of the committee some of the kind of longer term history here. So in terms of Scotland's health in comparison to the rest of the UK, it had been improving and improving on average until around 2010 or 2012, albeit it had always been worse comparatively than the rest of the UK. And there's a number of historical reasons for that that was summarised in a report by the Glasgow Centre for Population Health in 2016. But since 2012 onwards, what we've seen is that life expectancy hasn't improved at all on average. And in the poorest areas of Scotland, and indeed the poorest areas across the UK, life expectancy has gone down. Now, obviously, mortality and life expectancy is a pretty blunt instrument to measure health, but we can look at other measures such as healthy life expectancy, which combines mortality measures with self-reported health, which starts to get into the experience of morbidity and ill health. And what we see there is quite a shocking set of figures that predates the pandemic. So between 2011 and 2019, average healthy life expectancy declined by 2 years. And if you look at the most deprived 20% of the population, healthy life expectancy actually declined by 3.5 years. And all of that predated COVID. Now, we're quite clear now that the causes of those stalled mortality trends and healthy life expectancy trends are related to the change in economic policy after the great financial crash in 2008. So the change towards austerity policies and the implications that's had for social security benefits, for public service funding, and all of that sort of austerity package has had a massive impact. And all of that has left the population in a very vulnerable state when the pandemic hit. And so in a sense, it's no surprise that in that context of stalled life expectancy trends and declining healthy life expectancy, a global pandemic impacting on the population would simply exacerbate those trends. And so I think that you know, COVID and long COVID has probably made an impact on that. But I would also agree with what Pamela Smith has said, that austerity has also created a context of poor quality work, of precarious work, of a whole range of labour market demand factors that means that economic inactivity has become more common as well. So there's a sort of polycrisis of factors that are driving the trends that we're now seeing.
Thank you, Gerry. That's very helpful. I'm going to move on to Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Just to follow up some of the questioning from the Convener, because I think this is really at the heart of what the committee is trying to understand here in terms of what's been happening in the labour market. We heard some interesting evidence last week from our panel around the reasons for the reduction in economic activity and whether that was related to directly related to health, so whether it was people, for example, with long COVID who were struggling to work, or was it more about other factors such as people deciding after 2 years of home working they were going to take early retirement, for example, because they didn't want to go back to, you know, an office working environment. I'm interested to get people's perspectives on that, whether to what extent do you think this is health related, directly health related, or whether there are other factors, particularly amongst the 50 and 60 year old age group. Professor, maybe you could start if you've got any thoughts on that.
Yes, I mean, I don't have any sort of direct evidence to draw on, so this is mainly anecdotal, but I think it's probably going to be a combination of factors. So, I mean, as has kind of previously been mentioned, there are kind of some very important health drivers that are contributing. Most of these were evident prior to the pandemic, so these are largely non-communicable disorders that should be largely preventable through sort of appropriate public health approaches, health promotion approaches. But the fact is, I mean, we still haven't made that transition as a health system, whether in Scotland or across the UK. So it remains largely a kind of a curative health system with the vast majority of funding directed at hospitals rather than at public health approaches. So, I mean, I think health is a contributory factor, but I think, I mean, clearly the pandemic has been a massive disruptive catalyst for people thinking about their lives in the kind of wider context. And I think anecdotally, a lot of people are making choices about having different priorities and trying to live differently. So I think that is also likely to be contributing.
Okay, thank you. I don't know. Pamela, you got any thoughts on this?
Yeah, I mean, from a health perspective, we know the mental health and anxiety, depression are the areas of health that are increasing in terms of the economic inactivity, particularly amongst young people, and cited more for a reason why people are leaving the labour market. So I think there are issues around mental health, and there's a whole cocktail of factors that are impacting on mental health. People are experiencing chronic stress, and that's then manifesting itself in other health conditions, you like diabetes, high blood pressure, heart conditions, etc. But it isn't all down to the health conditions themselves, because we know that 58,000 people who are in active duty health conditions do want to work. And I think it's coming back to some of the earlier comments around the flexibility of work within the labour market and the ability to access fair and healthy work. A lot of the individuals who experience the poorest health have the lowest skills level and often enter the more precarious sectors of the labour market. They don't often have the luxury of working from home as well. And the cost of living crisis is likely to exacerbate their mental health and anxiety as well. So I think there are issues around the types of jobs, the availability of work, and the access to that work, particularly for those with poorer health, and the need for more mental health support in work to prevent people falling out of work.
Thank you. I can maybe bring in Susie Fitton on this if I can, because I noticed in your written submission you make reference to the Financial Times analysis showing that the UK is the only country in the developed world where people have continued dropping out of the workforce in ever greater numbers beyond the acute phase of the pandemic. So there's clearly a specific UK issue here, and that will apply equally or perhaps more so to Scotland. And I wonder if you have any thoughts on what's driving that here as opposed to other countries.
So the analysis last month by the Financial Times of OECD figures and the quarterly labour force survey showed that the rates of chronic illness shot up during the pandemic and continue to climb, with millions of working age people across the UK now experiencing multiple health conditions, so comorbidities. And the analysis made clear that the number of working age people in the UK unable to work due to chronic pain had climbed by almost 200,000 in the past 2 years relative to its former trajectory. The second biggest contributor to the rise in worklessness has been people dropping out of the workforce due to mental illness, and this has obviously already been mentioned by other panellists, and I'm sure that this is something that many of us may want to get into more detail later on in the session. In terms of our focus, Inclusion Scotland is obviously focused on what factors have contributed to disabled people and people with long-term conditions in Scotland being economically inactive, and what are the drivers behind that. All the figures have shown for some time that disabled people in Scotland are considerably more likely than those who are not disabled to be economically inactive. In 2021, over 380,000 disabled people aged 16 to 64 were economically inactive. I think it's important to realise that whilst rates of economic activity are much higher for disabled people than non-disabled people, this doesn't reflect less willingness to work. For example, in 2019, around a quarter of inactive disabled people wanted to work, and that was higher than the proportion of inactive non-disabled people, so less than one-fifth. And I wanted to make plain that there are a wide range of factors which contribute to disabled people's economic inactivity in Scotland, and those factors were present pre-pandemic, during the initial shock, and then also in this phase of adjustment to the virus. And these factors include poor health outcomes in general for disabled people, a mental health crisis, which we've mentioned, and poorly constructed and at times underfunded mental health services. We've also made clear that poverty and health inequality are big factors, and that's doubly true for disabled people. The persistence of the disability employment gap in Scotland and the barriers that disabled people experience finding and keeping employment, which can lead to them leaving work or not looking for work, are very important in this discussion. And unfair treatment at work during the pandemic has led to some disabled people to leave work and not look for work. And the impact of long COVID, which we've mentioned, and workplace issues experienced by disabled people who are at high risk of the virus is also a factor.
OK, thanks very much. Can I maybe ask Professor McCartney for his thoughts on this question? Essentially, this point about is it about ill health, or are there other factors driving people leaving the workforce?
Okay, thank you. So you're obviously going to hear from Tom Waters and John Byrne Murdoch later on in today's session, both of whom have done very relevant work here. So Tom's done some work with Understanding Society data sets. John Murdoch, his data has already been referred to. But what I would highlight are two things here. So even before the pandemic, we had a big problems with rising mental health problems being reported across the population, particularly in younger age groups. That's going to drive, a withdrawal from the labour market. We've got rising levels of poor self-rated health, which are a big contributor to the healthy life expectancy statistics that I was referring to. So again, that's a massive driver. So you've got that context, and in an extent, COVID is a much more minor, in some ways, sort of impact compared to that decade of problems that we've related to the austerity problems. Now, The pandemic is often seen in terms of the direct impacts of COVID, so the infectious disease impacts, but of course there's two other big impacts. So we've already discussed some of the social impacts of the changes to employment practices, changes to people's incomes, people's social interactions around the pandemic relating to periods of lockdown and changing working practices. So that will matter for people's health. But we've also seen a big impact on healthcare services. So as the NHS and social care had to change its model of delivery over the pandemic, and as we've accumulated a large amount of unmet healthcare needs, that's a lot of people waiting for healthcare intervention. And it's not a surprise, in a sense, that that group of people might be less likely to be still in the labour market as they're waiting for their operations, for, you know, joint replacements, for mental health interventions, for a whole range of different things. So that impact on the health service will also be having an impact. But I can't emphasise enough that COVID has just been the sort of cherry on the cake of an awful decade of health trends that are rooted in the economy. So it's the economy that has driven poor health. And now we're sort of reaping the unfortunate rewards of having that much poor health in the economy, so that we've got less people available and healthy to work in the labour market. Okay.
Thank you. Can I move on to Alex Rowley, please?
Yeah, thank you and good morning. Could I start with Pamela Smith and ask, in terms of, I mean, this word crisis has been used a lot these days. We seem to have crisis everywhere. But if mental health is in a crisis, and as Professor McCartney said, it was an issue before COVID, but even now, in terms of long COVID, one of the symptoms that's been described is mental health. So where are we at in Scotland? Do you believe that there is an understanding of the issues around mental health? Do we actually know the numbers of people suffering mental health? And what, as policymakers, should we be arguing that the government should be doing?
I think there are figures available, as you know, in the submissions around the increase in mental health as the chronic and long-term health condition. And I think the issues that we need to tackle mental health in a number of interconnected ways as well. So often if mental health, stress and anxiety has been the reason for people falling out the labour market, it remains the reason why a lot of people don't then move back or into the labour market. And I think there are a lot of good initiatives around there, like the Individual Placement Service, where SAMH have a model of place and train, supporting through community mental health services individuals in that journey into work and towards work. They are very expensive approaches because they cover different multiple needs and issues. Are very person-centred, needs-led, and they often happen within a locality and a place where people live and work. So in terms of tackling and supporting mental health, it isn't only about health services, it's about all of those integrated services that can relieve some of the pressure, some of the stress that exacerbates and contributes to the mental health and wellbeing. So the mental health strategy in itself won't resolve the mental health issues if we don't resolve a lot of the consequences that drive poor mental health. And Professor McCartney referred to some of that around the labour market, around the economy, and indeed a lot of the precarious employment in some of the sectors that have less access to occupational health services as well, don't help any of the mental health support that individuals might be getting from a clinical perspective. So it's an integrated action plan that individuals need, and it's integrated whole systems approaches that we need to look at deploying to tackle mental health and the economy and employment simultaneously.
Okay, thank you. Susie Fitton, could I ask you the same similar question? As parliamentarians, what should we be looking at and what should we be expecting for government in terms of rising cases of mental health, the impact it's having, and the treatment that's either there or not there?
research in lockdown with disabled people across Scotland indicated that disabled people were experiencing a mental health crisis. Now, obviously, as you've mentioned, the term crisis is used possibly too readily, but certainly our survey findings showed that disabled people were being pushed to the brink by the pandemic, and that there was an indication that some of these mental health problems would continue even as restrictions were lifted. We discovered that the social care system during lockdown had basically collapsed, so that disabled people had their social care removed or reduced, and that they were thrust into caring roles that they hadn't previously had for either themselves or for relatives. Disabled people were worried about food insecurity. They were worried about losing their own job, given that the rate of redundancies for disabled people was disproportionately high, and reduced hours was also an issue. The indications from lockdown were not good in terms of disabled people's mental health. Disabled people often report poorer outcomes than health outcomes than non-disabled people anyway. Obviously other panelists have mentioned the impact of poverty and wealth inequalities on health and health inequalities in Scotland, and this is now well understood and largely accepted within the health community. Disabled people are much more likely to live in poverty, and this has a significant impact on mental health. Nearly half of all those living in poverty in the UK are either disabled people or live in a household containing a disabled person. Disabled people have significantly higher costs that are associated with living with disability. And once these costs are taken into account, 500,000 Scottish disabled people and their families are living in poverty, which is 48% of the total of all people in Scotland living in poverty. And I think there's growing evidence that the COVID crisis pushed more families into poverty. Disabled people are more likely to say their finances have been negatively impacted, and they're worried about accumulating more debt. And given that we're in a cost of living crisis at the moment, it's only likely that these factors are going to intensify. So we would argue for a whole systems approach that tackles health inequality and poverty of disabled people is absolutely critical if we are going to start to address mental health issues in Scotland for disabled people. We know that people living in our most deprived communities are more than twice as likely to experience anxiety and depression, and are three times more likely to die by suicide. These inequalities have been shown to have been caused in large part by austerity and the drastic impact on the income and therefore health of the poorest and most vulnerable populations in Scotland. So our view is that efforts to tackle poverty and inequality are quite key to efforts to improve mental health. We're obviously concerned about the recent announcements of cuts to funding for mental health provision in Scotland, and we're concerned about waiting lists for child and adolescent mental health services, particularly for disabled young children, young people. And those are the things that often get talked about. But really, we would like to see a whole systems approach to tackling the poverty experienced by disabled people as a key element in tackling mental health issues.
Thank you. Professor McCartney, I'm really trying to... mental health is increasing right across the population, disabled people, able-bodied people. What as politicians, what as parliamentarians, policymakers, should we be looking at here? Is the data good enough? What actions should we be looking at?
So I can address the question about, you know, what is the scale of the problem, and I'll try and do that. So the best source of data we've had on the number of people suffering from mental health problems comes from survey data. So we've got various sources of that. So there's an Understanding Society survey, which follows people up over time across Great Britain. We've got the Scottish Health Survey, and there's other surveys available for other parts of the UK. And on that measure, what you see is that mental health was either fairly stable or improving for older adults until about 2010. And then after that, the number of people who report suffering from mental health problems rose dramatically for those under 65, but continued to improve for those aged over 65. And that lasted until 2019. Now, unfortunately, once the pandemic hit, we have really poor survey data because the response rates to those surveys went down, partly because we couldn't do the door knocking to collect the survey data. And when you have such low response rates, or when you do the surveys by telephone, the data become so biased that it's difficult to make much of an inference from them. And unfortunately, that's the position we're in for those survey data sources. The alternative to that are service-based data. So you can look at the number of people who are in contact with services for mental health problems. So, for example, the number of people who are admitted or discharged from hospital, or the number of people in touch with primary care services. But again, there are problems with these. So in terms of secondary care, essentially we have a limited number of beds, and you reach that threshold quite quickly, and it doesn't really tell you about variance in need, because essentially the services prioritise those with the greatest need, and those beds are continuously full, and so you don't get a picture about whether need is rising or falling, because those beds are just constantly in use. In terms of primary care data, we've had a lot of changes to the primary care data sets over the years, sort of with the history of a variance in GP data collection systems over time has meant that that data has never really been nationally comparable. And there's been a lot of work done by Public Health Scotland and others to create a SPIRE system, which would allow for that nationally comparative data set, which could be really important in terms of people being more able to access primary care than secondary care for these kinds of issues. But that's still in development, and we don't have good data yet on trends in mental health contacts from that data system. That was a very long answer to say that actually from 2020 onwards, we don't have great data to allow us to know the scale of the problem. But I think anecdotally, and that's always dangerous, but anecdotally you would expect it to be much worse than it was pre-pandemic for all the reasons that yourselves and other speakers have indicated.
So you'd like to come in?
Yeah,
so I wanted to make three points really. The first is, I've just come back from Singapore and I met with the team that has been surveying mental health across Singapore. So a comparable size country. They've got very low prevalences of mental health problems, and that has been sort of persistently found, including extending over the pandemic. So I think one sort of issue that as parliamentarians you may want to do is just look internationally, and I can certainly make connections with that team if that would be helpful. When I asked them about why, I mean, they feel they've got such low prevalence of mental health disorders, I mean, they pointed to sort of economic prosperity, relative lack of inequalities, low prevalence of substance disorders, whether that's sort of alcohol or drugs, etc. But that's kind of one thing that I think would be important to do, to look internationally. The second thing is, actually, in Scotland, we've got the best data sources in the world. So, I mean, I think this is part of the reason I've been brought in. We created a platform. We've got real-time data on virtually everybody that's linking across general practice, hospital, social data. Those data are housed in Public Health Scotland. And so I think but our permissions are only COVID-specific. So if you were to ask us specifically to look into mental health issues and how the pandemic has affected us, we could certainly run that analysis, and there's very few places in the world that could do that. So that could be done. It wouldn't take very long, actually, but it would need a specific request, and we would have to negotiate permissions. The third issue I wanted to talk about was, I mean, and this I think links to the earlier question, is that in Scotland, at the University of Edinburgh, we've got the Smart Data Foundry, so we've got economic data on a million people, granular data, provided by NatWest Group. So it's 140,000 people in Scotland. So these are data hosted within the sort of national secure data environment. And at the moment, I think no country in the world has been able to link economic data and health data, but we could be the first place to do that in Scotland. That would answer a lot of these questions where we're providing as a, I mean, anecdotal evidence or in relying on out-of-date survey data that could be provided in real time. And as far as I understand, speaking with the team yesterday, they feel that other banking groups are actually willing to provide data. So, but again, that would need a specific instruction from parliamentarians.
Thank you. If I just before I move on to Mr. Fairley. So Aziz, I know that you're leading a long-term study on long COVID. Can I ask what you're hoping to learn from it?
Yeah, so this is work funded by the Chief Scientific Office of the Scottish Government. And so what we're trying to understand is the prevalence of long COVID in Scotland. Now that's a difficult question because it depends on how you define long COVID. There are symptomatic-based approaches, as, for example, been undertaken by the Office for National Statistics, and I see the kind of evidence is cited in the papers. So I think that's one approach. Another approach is to what extent these are impacting on health systems, so encounters in general practice or actually ongoing referrals into to the hospital sector. So that's kind of one issue that we're looking at. So we're working with different definitions there. The second issue then we're trying to work out is how can we actually begin to predict who's most at risk of developing long COVID. And just in preparation for this session, I have asked the team just to see whether we can actually begin to look at economic activity. So we do have data on sick lines that are being issued by general practitioners. So we've been able to do a very preliminary analysis of that. And we've been able to sort of identify some risk factors that are associated with increased risks of being signed off with long COVID in Scotland. That needs more work. I mean, there are issues with kind of GPs' reluctance to code for long COVID in records because long COVID is largely a diagnosis of exclusion. And until we've got appropriate diagnostic services up in play in Scotland, that remains challenging. But nonetheless, we've been able to get some indicators as to which factors are associated with being signed off for long COVID, and certainly there is the possibility of doing some in-depth work there.
Okay, thank you. That's interesting. Jim?
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, panel, and thanks very much for coming in. One of the things, as I've been sitting here listening last week and this week, was are we actually asking you the right questions to get where we want to go? And Aziz, I think you just started to touch on it there. Are we giving the right questions to the panels to be able to get to what it is that we're trying to work out, which is how do we get economically inactive people back into the workplace? Are we doing that in this committee?
Maybe I can kick off. I think the questions are all appropriate. I think my kind of slight frustration is that we in Scotland have got absolutely phenomenal data sets now. They're in the health space. There's no country in the world that's got the data that we've got. And how do we actually now begin to deploy them rather than sort of beyond questions of whether vaccines are working or not? And that's a kind of a relatively, it's a relatively straightforward move. Because we don't have permissions at the moment. We don't have instruction to do this. So the reason we are able to do this in COVID is because Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport at the time, Jean Freeman, asked us to do this. And then everything sort of fell into place subsequently. So we need high-level instruction that this needs to be done. And I think then there's a wider questions of can we actually move to whole system intelligence for NHS Scotland? That's going to be absolutely crucial if we want to improve services, begin to bend the cost curve. And then this issue about bringing health data, and these data are so rich, bringing those together with economic data, and that, again, potentially could be done. There are major investments that have been made But again, somebody needs, senior needs to instruct the country to move in this direction.
Pamela.
Maybe just moving on in terms of the evidence into practice and policies. So I think the committee spoke previously about DWP data and benefit data and their ability to marry some of that up. So I'm probably most interested in how we tackle and identify the individuals, because we can have data at population level and it can tell us certain things. But we know that most of the economic recovery and social renewal actions have to happen at a place, and those places are in the neighbourhoods and the communities where people live and work. So I'm also interested in how the data can marry up to some of the intelligence held in local government, who will be providing support for people in social rented housing, hardship grants through the education system, through social work, through community justice, etc. A lot of the individuals who are economically inactive and who have a lot of the inequalities and a lot of the health issues we're talking about are engaging and receiving support from a whole raft of public services. So again, it comes back to the point that other panellists raised around that whole system marrying up of data, but not only at that high level in terms of population health, but being able to drill down and actually know who the individuals are. And there were some good examples through the Young Persons Guarantee, where the data hub for young people had data from DWP, HMRC exported into other data that local partners were able to provide, and you could actually get information down to individual level at a partnership level locally to look at how that could then be needs-led, person-centred and place-based. So I think there's different levels of data that we need, and different uses for that data in terms of policy and practice. So I think, you know, what Professor was saying there is very helpful, marrying up a lot of the data we already have, but also looking at, well, what does that mean in practice if we're actually going to have policies, programmes and approaches that will start to shift the curve for those individuals.
So you, excuse me, you're the head of economy and poverty in Public Health Scotland. Aziz is talking about the quality of data that we have in the health system. Do you have the same level of data? And I know for a fact that in my own constituency, we've got 5,155 children living in poverty. Yeah. That's clearly at a granular level. Does Public Health Scotland have that level of data that could be married into a whole system approach?
Yeah, so Public Health Scotland, there's a number of public agencies have a lot of different data sets, so you'll know the work that's ongoing to try and marry up a lot of that data. You know that local government have kind of other data profiles within their systems. The issue is a lot of the high-level data is fed by a lot of different systems. So, yes, public health has loads of data. I also have to say that I'm only 7 months in Public Health Scotland, and I'm more from a policy and practice background, taking the data, taking the evidence, taking the intelligence, and figuring out what best to do about it to resolve the problem and improve the outcomes. Public Health Scotland has a new local working programme where we're looking to work with all public sector partners locally, looking at those economic and health profiles and looking at how we can start to deliver and develop programmes at work. A lot of that started with the Community Planning Partnership Local Outcome Improvement Plans, where we're trying to integrate a lot of those local actions. So there certainly are, through Public Health Scotland and Improvement Service and other public sector partners, community profile data that touches on a lot of the economic and health, as well as other factors that impact on wellbeing. And again, it just takes the time and the ask to look at how we profile them together.
Yeah, 2 seconds before you go into that. Just an observation. No, you speak first, I'll come back to you.
Yes, just to kind of answer that specific question, and Public Health Scotland's got sort of various departments, et cetera. I mean, it's a large organisation, but the group that I work with, we have data on 5.4 million people across Scotland. So these are GP data linked with unique identifiers to hospitalisation, mortality, prescribing. In the context of COVID, it's been sort of vaccination, testing, et cetera. We also now have a linkage to census data as well, and a variety of other data sets. So we've got very, very granular data. Those data get updated on a weekly basis every Tuesday morning into Public Health Scotland. And so, I mean, if there was an instruction, resources, permissions, I could give you data on this question of what does mental health look like in Scotland on a weekly basis, and those answers could be available with you, I mean, as long as those other things fill into place within a couple of weeks.
Just an observation, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is the fact that we've got such an extensive range of data and Singapore are reporting much lower rates of mental health, well-being, what have you, is it because we've got the data that we know about it and that Singapore actually just don't know about it?
No. Sorry. So they're running sort of surveys regularly, and their response rates are actually very good to those surveys. So this is longitudinal.
Yeah.
And actually, what I was told by that team was that even though the rates are incredibly low, their government officials are not satisfied. They're still concerned.
Thank you. I just wanted to get that clarity on record. Have I got time for another question? Yeah. Okay. Sorry, I'm enjoying this, convener. Jerry, I'd like to come to you, if that's okay. You talked about this issue that we're looking at just now is predated, going back to the austerity policies of 2008. Is there any data or studies that would say how far back these health inequalities have gone in Scotland? Does it only go back to 2008 since the crash, or does it go back even further? And are we living with a chronic long-term problem is kind of what I'm trying to get to.
Thank you. So there's various periods, if you like, of issues. So if you look at pretty rudimentary data on health inequalities across Great Britain, you find that those measures of health inequalities declined between the 1920s and the 1970s before subsequently increasing. We've got much better data from about 1981 onwards on the extent of health inequalities, and they rapidly widen from the 1980s onwards until about 1997-98 when they start to stabilise. They then widen again from 2010-12 onwards, and have been kind of widening on most measures ever since. In terms of, so that's really thinking about mortality. When you think about other measures of health, you see inequalities in almost all measures of health, whether it's mental health, whether it's mental well-being, whether it's self-rated health, whether it's admissions to hospitals. So you see sort of similar trends across all of these measures. On average, sort of life expectancy mortality had been improving until around 2012, and then it's been flat since then on average, then declining during COVID. But the inequalities in that have widened. So you've got declining life expectancy from 2012 onwards in our poorest 30% or so of areas. Mental health problems really start to worsen for the under 65s from around 2014, 2015 onwards, rising from a prevalence of about 15% to about 20% over that time period. As I said, the survey data aren't of high quality thereafter.
Okay, so we're looking at, so from 2008 onwards, I think it was yourself, Pamela, said that we had chronic stress issues. Where is that coming from? Is it because of economic problems? Is it because of austerity? Is it because of poverty? What is causing the chronic stress?
Yeah, I think Professor McCartney and the Population Health in Glasgow have published some information and data around the austerity and the links with health from 2008. But to answer the question around the manifestation of mental health and austerity, is basically linked to poverty, and it's linked to lower incomes, precarious employment. It's all part of that same cycle of inequality, and health inequality is being made worse by anxiety and stress, lack of money, lack of healthy food, lack of diet and exercise to improve health as well. All comes back to poverty, unemployment, and even poor work. So we know that most children in poverty have an adult working. So poverty isn't only about labour market inactivity and unemployment. It's about income, and it's about income levels. And a lot of that, again, comes back to the economy and how the labour market operates.
I was going to say, we've got large numbers of people who are claiming benefits who are in work. Yep. So it's not about being labour inactive. It's about the quality of life that they're living.
Yep. So there's the two sides of it. And a lot of people with health conditions are managing it in work as well. So not everyone who's got a chronic health condition becomes inactive. Again, a lot of it depends on the nature of the job they're doing and what resources and tools and resilience they have to manage some of those health conditions as well.
That's great. Sorry, Jim Fairley, we'll need to move on for time. John Mason, please.
Thanks very much, convener. I mean, probably to build on some of the things that have already been asked, but if I could start with yourself, Professor Sheikh. You were saying, you know, we can compare mental health between Scotland and Singapore. I mean, can we also compare, say, long COVID numbers in Scotland and France, or can we compare economic inactivity? I mean, are the definitions the same for all of these things between different countries?
So, I mean, I think with long COVID, clearly we're kind of struggling with definitions internally in Scotland and the UK. That said, I mean, I think that there is the possibility for doing comparative work across countries, jurisdictions, because there has been sort of, I mean, these teams are working quite closely together. There's a lot of sharing of information, etc. So that could be done. I think that's an answerable question around economic activity. It's not really my area of expertise. So I think others are probably better placed to comment.
OK. Ms Smith, there's been a lot of comparisons drawn between ME and long COVID and similarities. And I think, to be fair, we've struggled with ME over the years to really get definitions to get. And GPs seem to vary quite a lot. Is it a fair comparison between the two?
Again, I'm not a clinical expert, but from the information made available to me, a lot of the symptoms and a lot of it's self-reported as well. So people will report their symptoms of fatigue, tiredness, etc. And there's other respiratory conditions as well. So I think, as we've heard, it isn't quite clear in terms of the definitions. A lot of symptoms will manifest themselves in the same way, but it might be different causes.
And do you think it will become clear over time, or are we going to be like with the ME situation, or at least some ME people would claim, that we've still not really pinned it down after, whatever, 30, 40 years?
I think there will always be something underlying. It's the same with mental health conditions. You know, a lot of that is self-reported by individuals, and some of that is questioned. You know, that people are looking at it as an excuse to maybe opt out of work, etc. So I think we have to be clear on the definitions, on the collection of the data, and a lot of it is about self-reporting, but it does limit an impact on people being able to participate fully in the labour market, irrespective of how it's defined.
Mm-hmm. Professor McCartney, were you going to come in on this?
Yeah, thank you. So I would point members towards a publication on the 3rd of November. It's a joint publication between NICE, that's the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence from based in London, the Royal College of General Practitioners and Healthcare Improvement Scotland. And it's a rapid evidence review about managing the long-term effects of COVID-19. And it goes through a series of sections about both the identification, assessment and diagnosis and the criteria for that, the evidence about treatment and so forth. And what it shows very clearly is the range of uncertainties at each stage of this. So there's different definitions used, there's uncertainty in the criteria for pinning it down. There's uncertainty about what works in terms of management and treatment and supportive environments. And what it lays out is a really clear research agenda of answerable questions that need to be done. And I think if there was resource to be allocated towards research in this area, that would be a very good starting point, because we need to understand how to diagnose it, how to assess it, how to treat it. And there'll be a range of different options and inferences from other conditions that might or might not work. But all of this needs tested and we need an evidence base for this, because we're kind of under pressure, I guess, to act in the absence of evidence at the moment. But that can do more harm than good. It can create a lot of iatrogenic harm. So that's harm from healthcare treatments. So we really need an evidence base and an experimental context to learn more about this.
OK, thanks for that. I mean, while you're we've got you there, can I just press you? You've said a few times that you know, we've got a number of health issues linked to austerity and the economy, economic factors. But I mean, would it not be the case that some issues like obesity and maybe mental health, are, you know, are also seen very much in the better off parts of the population, and these have been problems we've not been able to pin down and really sort, despite that.
Both are true. So just to very, very briefly rehearse the evidence on austerity. So we've got evidence at three different levels about the negative impacts of austerity. So we've got it through international comparisons of more or less austere regimes over time, country and place. And that shows that countries that have implemented periods of austerity have had much worse mortality trends. We've got evidence at local government level, so the councils that have had the biggest cuts to their budgets and the biggest cuts to their services, whether it's health or social care or on aggregate level, sort of benefit levels, pension credits and the like, they have much worse health trends. And then you can look at it at individual and household level. So we've got evidence from things like Understanding Society that people that were more affected by changes to like benefit cuts or benefit sanctions or changes to the benefit system that reduced their eligibility all had massive negative impacts and often on mental health. But we do, I agree, we also have issues around obesity and mental health that are not helped at all by austerity, but predate that. So we had a large rise in the prevalence of the population who are obese from 1995 when data started onwards. That plateaued after 2010, but we see the lagged effects of that now. Mental health problems actually had been fairly flat on survey measures until around 2015, after which they diverged. So you had a rise in mental health problems for people aged under 65 and a decline in mental health problems reported for those aged over 65. The last thing to say is that we need to be careful about some of the inequalities data that we use routinely. So these are area-based measures, and we know that the vast majority of people who are deprived in terms of their income deprivation or employment deprivation don't actually live in the most deprived 20% of areas. And so when you look at the statistics across the population, you need to remember that is a very crude categorisation of need. It's helpful because it's routinely available, it's quickly available, but it doesn't, so it kind of masks inequalities that you might measure by social class or by educational attainment or by income levels. And it mixes people up who are more or less deprived by using these area-based measures.
Well, that's extremely helpful, actually. That's really interesting. Thanks. If I could switch over to Ms. Fitton. In your evidence, in your written evidence, a few times it comes up about the attitude of employers, both, I think, towards disability, but also towards long COVID. And one of the quotes was, workers were faced with disbelief and suspicion, with around one-fifth, 19%, having their employer question the impact of their symptoms. Can you say a little bit more about that and what we should be doing, you know, to either educate employers or help employers or whatever?
So I would say that there is an opportunity to approach participation in the labour market by disabled people and people with long-term illness. So that would, to our mind, include many people with long COVID. We would say that there's an opportunity to approach participation differently as part of a post-COVID kind of renewal. And that really is going to involve employers and a switch in focus in terms of how we approach inactivity, but also how we support disabled people and those with long-term illness into work. So nearly one in four people inactive because of ill health in the UK actually want to work or are seeking work, but are unable to start because of barriers that they experience in terms of entering or re-entering the workplace. So we think it's really important that we have a switch in focus, and also that we make use we ensure that changes that have been made to working patterns as a response to the pandemic, particularly in terms of large numbers of employees working from home, provide an opportunity to really look at workplace adjustments and flexibility as a normal part of employment practice. So not just as reasonable adjustments to disabled people, but as a kind of an inherent part of employment, of real flexibility. So there's a certain irony, for example, that changes made to working patterns as a response to the pandemic were adjustments long called for by individual disabled people and those managing long-term health conditions. And disabled people reported to us that they felt that the response to the pandemic was a response to the majority that disabled people are not part of. So for years, people with energy impairments or chronic illness have been asking to work from home, and employers said it was impossible. So there's an uncomfortable irony there.
That was good evidence of the fact it was ironic that had happened. And I mean, can I press you then? Can you see any sign of employers now thinking differently? Because we hear that a lot of employers are really struggling to get staff, and that would suggest that they might be more adaptable to both people with long-term conditions and disabilities and so on. Do you think that is happening? Have you seen that happening?
So we offer as part of our employability work, we offer internship opportunities for disabled people, and we have lots of links with employers across Scotland. And there are many employers that are very, very keen to learn from the pandemic, to think about workplace adjustments as workplace adjustments rather than just adjustments for disabled people or people with long-term impairment, long-term illness. I think there is a real opportunity for employers to really explore formal and informal flexible working that could support disabled people into work in terms of remote working, obviously working from home, but also other remote accessible locations, offering flexibility in terms of compressed hours, and all of the things around flexible working can support disabled people with long-term illness and, you know, things like energy impairments or pain conditions and fatigue conditions that may really just mean that they need to work at different times when they're well. I mean, I think one of the things that we would say is that we need a switch in focus in terms of employability support. So for many, many years, for decades really, the emphasis on tackling disabled people's economic inactivity and their unemployment has been predicated on the idea that what stops disabled people working is a deficit or a lack of something to do with the disabled person themselves. So a lot of this is around, you know, supporting disabled people to get closer to the labour market because of a presumed lack of skills or education or a lack of ability to self-manage a health condition. And our view is actually what you really need to do is to focus on employers and how inclusive and accessible employment can be. We've ended up
we are running out of time. I'm going to have to, okay. I think we've got that point. That's great. I just wanted to give a final word to Ms. Smith, because you'd also said about poor treatment at work. And if we've got time, the fact there's backlogs in the NHS, is that affecting people getting back to work?
I think there are certain sectors within the economy, and particularly in smaller enterprises, SMEs, where individuals don't have the same access to occupational health services as well. There is Working Health Services Scotland, and that is available. But I think there is a lot of work to be done with employers and employees around access to support in work. A lot of employability services previously were about people who were unemployed, and it was a lot of it was about pre-employment support. But we know there's a lot more required in terms of in-work support to help people sustain work, whether it's through health to help people progress in work, whether they need to upskill and to address their work poverty so they can increase their earnings from employment and progression. So there is a lot more that has to be done around in-work support for employers and for employees and how we help to implement some of the ambitions around the Fair Work Action Plan.
We're going to have to stop now. I think that's our time.
Thank you. And that concludes part one of the impact of the pandemic on the Scottish labour market. I'd like to thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. And if the witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do that. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you. We will now continue to take evidence on the inquiry, and I'd like to welcome our second panel to the meeting. We have received apologies this morning from John Byrne Murdoch, who's a chief data reporter from the Financial Times. So please welcome Tom Waters, a senior research economist, and Tom Wernham, research economist for the Institute for Fiscal Studies, who are both joining us remotely, and Philip White, Director of IPPR Scotland, who joins us in person. Welcome. Thank you for giving us your time this morning. We estimate that this session will run to around 11:30 a.m. and each member should have approximately about 15 minutes each to speak to the panel and to ask their questions. For those witnesses who are attending remotely this morning, if you'd like to respond to an issue which is being discussed, please put R in the chat box and we'll try and bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may need to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. If I could just turn to questions to start with, and if I may begin by asking the first question, and I'll ask this to you, Philip, if I can, to start with. What are the main health conditions that account for long-term illness as the reason for economic inactivity in Scotland, in your opinion?
So, they are long-standing. I think that's maybe an issue that's going to come out through this session, that I think COVID has potentially exacerbated or shone a spotlight on conditions that have existed due to Scotland's relationship with health inequalities. That again is very long-standing. COVID did not create it. But, as an example, I pulled some stats from the Scottish Health Survey. If you go back to 2008, so, more than a decade, well before, you look at statistics that you've got, high numbers that aren't a healthy weight, you've got high levels, or at least a significant number, that suffer from cardiovascular conditions, long-term limiting illness, respiratory conditions, general, mental ill health. These are all really long-standing, and I think it is impossible to separate them out from the fact that health inequalities for Scotland has been an issue that has persisted for so long. You see it in the continued kind of high numbers of alcohol-related deaths, of drug-related deaths, high numbers of comorbidities within Scotland. That those are the ones that have existed for a long time. I don't think the pandemic may have exacerbated them in some instances, but they certainly didn't cause them or create them.
Thank you. If I could ask the same question to Tom Waters, please. I know we've got two Toms with W, so I'll have to say your full name.
Our focus has been looking at long COVID, so I don't think I have anything really to add above and beyond what Philip said in terms of wider health condition.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you. If we can move on to the next question, if I may. What can the statistics tell us about the impact of differing policy approaches, both pre, during and post-pandemic, between Scotland and the rest of the UK? Does anybody want to come in on that one?
In terms of response specifically to COVID, yes, and yes, the impact on health outcomes?
Yes.
I may be deferred, because I know IFS has done a bit of research in this at a UK level, which might provide some UK context, if I can then supplement, not to put IFS colleagues on the spot. Apologies.
Sorry, can you clarify the question? I'm not sure I quite...
Yes, sure. Sorry. Can you hear me? Just what can the statistics that we have tell us about the impacts of differing policy approaches, both pre and during and post-pandemic, between Scotland and the rest of the UK?
With respect to health?
Yes.
When you say policy...
Impact of, okay. Yep, COVID.
I don't think I have anything to contribute on that. We've focused on the economic policy of the UK government during COVID, and then looked at the impact of long COVID subsequently. But on kind of health policy,
Tom, maybe if I could ask about how can we fully understand the full picture around long COVID when its impact is spread around different statistical sets?
Yeah, I think it is a real challenge because, for a number of reasons, we measuring long COVID, understanding the extent of long COVID is a difficult thing to do because it getting the exact definitions right, and the way even things like changing question wording can change the number of people that report having long COVID. And of course, as well known, a lot of the much of the data around long COVID and particularly the data we've used it's very much self-reported. It's not kind of confirmed by objective measures, that sort of thing. So I think the approach that we've taken, which I think makes sense, is to say, okay, we're going to look at those who got long COVID, who reported getting long COVID. So we are obviously subject to those any downsides of that kind of self-reported measure, and then we're going to compare them and compare their trajectories pre versus post the pandemic, to people who before the pandemic looked quite similar to them. So, you know, similar levels of income, similar jobs, similar levels of pre-existing health conditions, things like that. And then we kind of look at, okay, what happens to their trajectories on, you know, outcomes like employment or earnings and things like that. So that's the kind of approach that we've taken to it.
Thank you, Tom. I'll move on to you, Meadow.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. One of the issues the committee is really keen to properly understand is to what extent the decline in the workforce post-COVID is down directly to health issues such as long COVID, or down to other factors such as people choosing to take early retirement. And I know IFS have done quite a lot of work around this, so I'm interested to get your perspectives, and I'll let the two Toms fight out between themselves who's going to answer the questions. But just to put this into context, we'd hope to have John Byrne Murdoch from the Financial Times this morning, but unfortunately he's not well. But I just want to quote a couple of things from the Financial Times. He wrote an article in July, basically saying that chronic illness was the main driver of stalled labour recovery. But then there was a more recent article in the Financial Times on the 2nd of November from Delphine Strauss, which quotes IFS research and says, these findings challenge the prevailing idea that ill health is the main explanation for the post-pandemic shrinkage in the UK workforce. So, you know, there's clearly a contradiction between, you know, these two articles and these two outcomes. So really interested to get IFS's perspective on what's actually going on here. Whichever Tom wants to start.
So I think part of the reason that early on a lot of people were suggesting this might be a main driver of what's going on is that looking at people who are inactive, increasing numbers of them were suggesting that health was the reason. However, if you look at the data on who is moving in and out of activity and inactivity, our colleagues, who I think you're going to actually be speaking to in a few weeks, have found that most of the people who have started saying that they are inactive due to health reasons have already been inactive for a very long time. So they're not people who are moving out of the labour force at the moment. And actually, if you look at the people who are moving out of the labour force, the main reason they're doing so is for retirement. So it doesn't look there as though health reasons are a main driver of the decline in activity.
And just to follow that up, Tom, before anybody else comes in, you know, you say people taking retirement. I mean, to what extent do we understand the reasons for that? Is that because, you know, there were people working from home for 2 years and they just decided they didn't want to go back into a workplace environment and they took early retirement? Or are there other factors behind that? Or do we have enough data to explain this?
I think I don't have much specific evidence to talk about that specific question, no.
I can speak a bit about that. I think it's a really important question. I think that is something that is not well understood. So you can think of a few possible reasons. So one is, you know, maybe you lost your job in the pandemic, or you spent a long time on furlough, and you kind of you kind of got used to or experienced, you know, not working, and perhaps you liked it more than you thought, and thought you might, and so you end up taking early retirement. That's the kind of what you might think of as a preferences explanation. Then the other explanations, you know, you lost your job during the pandemic, you're actually just unable to find a new one, and eventually at some point you kind of give up and retire. I think it's fair to say we don't kind of have definitive answers on these things, but one thing that is important is that most of the newly inactive people say that they don't want a job. So they aren't looking for one. That's why they're inactive. But they actually say they don't want one. That's quite a large proportion of them. And so that kind of perhaps suggests that it's less of the you know, unable to find a job kind of explanation. That might, I'm sure it's going on in some cases, but that isn't perhaps the primary driver. But I think this is something where definitely more research, more evidence would be really, really valuable.
Okay, thanks very much. I'll bring Philip in a second. I've got one follow-up question, if I can. We know there's a cost of living crisis. We know that household bills, energy, food have gone up substantially over the past few months. Is there any evidence that people who dropped out of the workforce, perhaps took early retirement thinking they had enough money that could sustain them, are now having to rethink that because of cost pressures and inflation?
I think we're probably kind of getting to the point now where we might be able to see those sorts of effects. So just because there's always a bit of a lag with when we get the data, we might be able to see those sorts of effects coming through. And in broad terms, that is the sort of thing that, we do have evidence from other kind of in some way similar events. So, we've got plenty of good evidence that if someone loses their job, their partner is more likely to go into work to compensate. And you can kind of think of the cost of living crisis making people poor. It's kind of analogous to that. So I think that is something we should be looking out for in the coming few months or so. But it's perhaps in where we're kind of just about getting to the point now where that might be possible to see in the most recent cuts of data.
Okay. Philip, why are you getting a comment?
I mean, so the IFS has done some of the most work on this. Yep. So I think to try and get beyond that, what you need to start trying to do is, inferring causal links between wider data sets. But I suppose I'll just throw one other into the mix. And I think, as Tom suggests, we will maybe start to see if it's true, the hypothesis is true, it start to come through in statistics that we'll get from now on, now that a bit of time has passed. But ONS undertook a large-scale survey among those aged, I think it was 50 to 64, who left the workforce during the pandemic. And it did show that among those who left, for whatever reason, their health was worse. Over and above that, it also asked them, their kind of views around leaving the workforce. And a large number of them said that they were not confident that their savings and resources would sustain them through their retirement. So I think there's clearly something else driving their decision to retire, if a significant number aren't confident that actually they'll be able to financially survive. So that's where you may start to see people come back into the workforce if that comes through and they've not been able to kind of sustain retirement through their savings and assets. But equally, it may start to suggest that there were other factors, other than just a pure desire to retire that were driving that decision. But as both Toms have said, kind of with the stats that we have right now, it's impossible other than to infer kind of causal links.
One more question. Yeah, thank you. So just follow on from that, I suppose my next question is, what do we need to do, therefore, to make it more attractive for people, the set we've talked about, to come back into the workforce? What are the barriers to them working? Do we need more flexible working, for example, from employers? Would that help? Or are there other interventions that would be useful?
And specifically in terms of those that have retired or just retired, I think there is a question. I think particularly in Scotland, actually, again, this is where trying to draw inferences from UK-wide statistics. So again, I think IFS's work will show that in particular those who have taken retirement were men who were in professional and ultimately better off occupations. We know that in Scotland, obviously the public sector makes up a significant proportion of the workforce. That means that there's a potential that those who were in higher professional classes are overrepresented amongst that group. Again, it's impossible to kind of start to disaggregate the data. If that is true, then it's very possible that it was a pure decision that I've done quite well throughout my career. The pandemic has tipped me over the edge and I've decided that that is me done.
And particularly in the health service, that might well be the case. People
so among those, obviously, higher managerial class, definitely. So if that comes true, I don't know if you're ever going to get those people back. Yeah. There are those, however, I think particularly with the abolition of the retirement age, there is a question. I think this also rings through with disabled people, and it was talked about in the panel before by Inclusion Scotland around kind of the social model and actually whether or not employers right now are fully equipped to be able to support people who don't fit into the usual mold of workers. Are they equipped to be able to actually help them back in and respond to their circumstances? So again, there's potentially a model of work that we have in the UK that still doesn't quite work for them, but again, there is a question that we may never get those workers back because they have just decided and their circumstances mean that they have no need to.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if the IFS want to comment on this specifically.
I agree with all that. I just add that you know, it's not always the case that we want. We shouldn't kind of be targeting like 100% employment rates, right? So it's not always the case that it's always better for someone to get back into work. And the thing we should be concerned about is when people are able to work and want to work, but aren't able to find a job for whatever reason. And so then, you know, you worry about lack of skills or financial disincentives and all those sorts of things. So if it's kind of more just like a pure lifestyle thing, but I think my perspective on that would be that that's somewhat less concerning than if it's someone, you know, not able to find a job. And so I think that that distinction, so I think it's quite important for them thinking about what the policy response should be.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I move on to Alex Riley, please? Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Can I ask Tom, the IFS research has noted that those with underlying health conditions are more likely to suffer from long COVID. Are there any particular underlying conditions which are more prominent amongst those suffering long COVID?
That is a good question. I'm just looking at Tom to see whether he knows.
It's not something we've looked at in particular, no.
Yeah, and I don't know if it's something that whether it's known from the previous ONS work on this. I'm not sure off the top of my head, I'm afraid.
And maybe if you can find that, then that would be great. Can I also ask then, how can statistical comparisons with other countries better help us to understand the root causes of both long-term sickness and labour market inactivity, and link these back to policy and funding? So these comparisons we talked earlier about some countries. Yeah.
Yeah, I think precisely because measuring long COVID is a bit of a challenge, doing kind of comparisons across countries has been a bit more difficult. That said, looking at inactivity in general, that's well defined. That's pretty well defined across countries. That's a pretty clear definition that lots and lots of countries measure the same, get the same measure of inactivity. Now, because our rise in inactivity, our rise in activity has been quite a lot larger than other countries, as the Financial Times articles have pointed out. But because ours is largely driven by people taking early retirement, that kind of drives you perhaps to look a little bit, think a bit about our pension systems perhaps as being some of the relevant factors. Might not be the only one, but things like pension freedoms and so on, perhaps playing some role in the uptick that we've had in retirement driven inactivity. So I think that's the kind of thing we should be looking at. But I'm not sure beyond this fact that the UK has seen this faster rise in inactivity, I'm not sure how much comparisons across countries has been done on that.
Okay. Philip, can I ask, in terms of different policies in Scotland and the rest of the UK, is there any statistical evidence showing any differences that policies are having an approach?
Activity in particular, for all, rather than long COVID specifically.
Yeah.
So obviously the primary one is employability, which exists in a bit of a complicated and convoluted landscape in that obviously Scotland Act 2016 devolves some elements, and that's what led to the creation of First Start Scotland. Obviously, you know, that services a sizable chunk of people, but the vast majority who are out of work, for example, or in receipt of benefits will go through a still reserved DWP job centre plus. So Scotland has obviously made efforts, and there's been a real focus on employability over the last few years in particular, not least as part of child poverty ambitions. I think there's a question about whether or not that is at the sufficient scale. So you take something like First Start Scotland, it's had, you know, over 67,000, I think, referrals since it was created back in 2018, going by the most recent stats. of those who started a job off the back of being referred to First Start Scotland, it's been just over 15,000. So there's a huge disparity, and more importantly, of those who started, 50% dropped out before completing the programme. Now, given that as a programme specifically designed for those who are disabled, have a long-term health condition, or are long-term unemployed, that clearly feels like a key driver. But I think the main issue that we've seen right now is just that it's not being delivered at scale.
Is there an impact from the introduction of things like universal credit? I think back to before the introduction of working families tax credits, where it was quite common to hear people talk about the poverty trap, that you know, people were worse off getting a job than they were staying where they were. And working families tax credits certainly addressed that, but we've had changes since then. I mean, has that impacted on people's willingness to or ability to get back into the labour market?
I don't know if it's impacted it. There are, I think it brings societal issues, and it brings, you know, I think what you have seen, and what certainly at the very least kind of qualitative, if not quantitative, evidence suggests, is that even just the aura around universal credit has really significantly impacted on people. You know, the conditionality and sanctions regime has caused really negative reactions for very justifiably good reasons for lots of people. There's also a question of, does it actually, you know, proactively and positively enable people to be able to find work? You know, you've got 15 minutes with an advisor quite often. They don't have time to kind of go through your specific circumstances. You're then kind of sent off on your way if you have work-related requirements to do, you know, 20 hours or so of kind of work-related activity, which is you sat at home by yourself on a laptop looking for jobs. You know, I think what we really miss is the person-centred proactive approach. So yes, there is a question around the impact universal credit has had in terms of, you know, what it has meant in terms of, you know, the amount available to families, the requirements that it brings, the negative connotations it brings, the stigma that it creates. But I think more than anything, what it is part and parcel of is a system that does not at times, or if ever, genuinely proactively help people into the workplace, as opposed to putting in place just instead bureaucratic barriers.
Thank you. John Mason, can I bring you in?
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, maybe to follow up some of these points, and maybe starting with Tom Waters, if I may. I mean, you said that like economic activity and so on is well defined and very much agreed between countries, if I understood you. Now, my understanding is that to be economically active, you only have to work 1 hour a week. And that somewhat surprised me when that was raised, because I would have thought 1 hour or 0 hours was much the same, whereas 35 hours is quite different. Is that correct?
So to be economically active, you either have to have a job, which could be a 1 hour a week job, or be looking for work. That's economically active.
Right. So, I mean, as far as the economy is concerned, surely as far as the economy is concerned, it's much better having somebody working 35 hours a week than 1 hour a week.
Yeah, so certainly. Yeah. So that's certainly right. I mean, it's quite unusual to find people who are in work and are working fewer than 16 hours a week. There aren't that many jobs that are advertised at fewer than 16 hours a week. I mean, yeah, certainly you're right. You know, broad terms, it's the number of hours worked that matters more than the number of people. That's certainly correct. A full-time job, you know, is roughly twice as many hours as a part-time one. So.
Okay, fair enough. And I mean, another issue that came up was that we count people as in employment, but they might be off quite long-term sick with, say, long COVID in particular, or something else. Would that create a problem comparing our data with other countries, or do you think that's fairly accepted internationally?
Mm. Yeah, that's a good point. So. I think that would depend. It would depend on how other things like sick pay regimes, how that might differ by countries, and so that could have an effect. So in the work we've done, what we found is when people get long COVID, they remain employed, and that they're still like literally tied. They have a job to that they could go back to, but they are much more likely to work 0 hours. They're off long term sick, basically. And so they would still show up in the statistics as being employed, as you say. But I guess it is possible that if you had a different country, might have a kind of a sick pay regime, which, you know, kind of severs the actual employment link, but you keep getting paid sick pay or something like that, then that sort of person might then show up as inactive. I'm not certain, I don't know enough about other countries' sick pay policies, but certainly in the UK, this someone in this situation who is not actually working, so they aren't actually producing anything in the economy, nonetheless shows up as employed rather than inactive. Yeah.
Okay, and the other point was that this whole question of early retirement. Now, from the individual's point of view, if they're well off, they've been a general practitioner or something like that, they can afford it. So we, in a sense, we don't need to worry about them as an individual. But does the economy as a whole not suffer if we've got a lot of 55-year-olds who just stop working?
Yeah, I think it's true that, you know, the size of the economy would go down if that happened. I think the way in which you might worry about that would be, I think the primary way you might worry about that would be for the fiscal implications. If you've got a highly paid person who stops working at 55, they were paying a lot of tax before, and now they're not going to be paying very much, or not as much tax. And so that has fiscal implications. I think that's the main dimension in which that sort of thing, it might be kind of concerning from a societal point of view. If someone doesn't want to work, they don't want to produce, you know, whatever it was they were working in, and therefore be paid for it. I'd see that as being kind of primarily sort of an individual decision, but the tax implications are something obviously that ultimately affects everyone.
Okay, that's helpful. Thanks. Mr. White, I don't know if you had any thoughts on any of these kind of points.
No, I think similar. So I think on the inactivity point, again, it's what you make the focus of your policy making, because I think what we view as inactivity is, you know, those people who have literally fallen out of the, you know, job, the labour market, and kind of, you know, I think the 1 hour is there because what it represents is that they have fully, you know, disengaged, fallen out. So that requires a very specific policy response as opposed to those who are in work or actively looking for work. So I think it depends what you're looking to try and make your policy response do. Are you trying to improve general conditions, which could be primarily for those who are in employment, or are you trying to genuinely find a way to actively encourage people back into the labour market? And again, like I think as both Toms have suggested already, within that inactive population, there is a significant chunk who just do not want to. I think there's a question about to what extent do you expend your resources and energy in trying to get them back in versus recognising that for quite often very valid personal reasons, they may never again join the labour market. So similarly, again, I think on the retirement point, it is a loss if those people, as Tom said, it is a loss if those people disengage, if they're no longer contributing to the economy, to revenue. The important bit is that your economy is built in such a way as that there is a healthy supply of workforce coming through after them in similarly well-paid, good jobs. And I think it's those structural issues that we haven't quite addressed yet in the UK and Scottish economy, to ensure that actually once your ageing population, which again we know that in particular Scotland is at real risk from, once you're, I was about to say fall off a cliff, but hopefully that's not a terrible turn of phrase, but once they disappear from the labour market, you need to ensure that your economy is structurally set up to ensure that there is a steady supply of workforce coming behind them. And I think maybe that's the bit that we have missed. So I think you want to ensure that people are not disengaging from the workforce for bad reasons, particularly if they want to stay in. But if they are disengaging for good reasons, the absolutely vital bit is not trying to get them back in, but ensuring that your economy is supporting everyone else coming after them.
Yeah, I mean that's quite interesting, because that's a more kind of nuanced approach than we sometimes get, that, you know, for some people it is better being out of work and for some people it's better being in work. Because, I mean, we talked about mental health in the previous session, and, I mean, presumably for some people the mental health problem is that they're working too many hours and they've got a bad work-life balance. So that could actually improve by them either reducing their hours or leaving the workforce. And then your point about, you know, workers coming through, I mean, given that our population's forecast to fall, has that just got to be bringing people in from other countries to bolster our workforce, or are there other answers to that?
So again, I think it's been well recognised that migration is absolutely crucial to Scotland's economy in a wide variety of sectors. There are concerns that the impact of Brexit is going to negatively impact on that. Equally then, that combined with ageing population, it almost starts to create a perfect storm. You start to restrict migration whilst also having an ageing population that is disengaging entirely from the workforce. You know, what are you left with? And I think that is... ensuring that you've got that supply of workforce ready. Equally, you know, we know from the sectoral impacts that some sectors in particular have been really impacted by the pandemic. But again, I think as witnesses last week suggested, those are trends that did not begin with the pandemic. They were already there. You know, if you look at retail, people had already started to shift online well before the pandemic. Hospitality, drinking culture has started to shift positively in that it's less of a kind of a feature. Manufacturing, obviously. There are lots of sectors that we're already starting to see reducing workforces well before the pandemic. The pandemic may have accelerated that and had a particular pronounced effect on it, but it's not entirely clear that those jobs are ever going to come back. Because what you've also seen is that while sectoral employment rates have been affected, sectoral inactivity has been affected, but employment hasn't. So those people are going somewhere. But again, the really important bit is ensuring that there is somewhere for them to go to. So upskilling, reskilling opportunities, you know, lifelong learning opportunities, ensuring that we're investing in new technologies. Obviously, it's a huge feature of the Scottish economy to start investing in net zero technology. Again, it's about scale. I don't think we're there at scale yet. I think we've made the right noises. We've certainly got the right approach and outlook about it, but the risk is that we are not scaling up early enough to ensure that those jobs and that skilled workforce is there. And that's where the crunch point of retirement, potentially migration and Brexit, will start to really hit.
Can I just bring Murdo in because he wants to comment on this point, then we'll come back to you, John.
Yeah, thanks very much. I mean, just as a follow-up on this whole labour market issue, one issue nobody's touched on yet is potential rises in unemployment, because the Bank of England, I think, last week suggested that unemployment is set to double. Now, if they're right, doesn't that raise a whole range of other issues, but means that the current tightness in the labour market that is the real issue might flip itself over, and we're no longer discussing the difficulty in finding people to do work. We're talking about the opposite problem, which is we then have people who are unemployed and can't get jobs.
Yeah, so again, I'll maybe let Thomas know that we'll want to kind of talk to the UK picture. Again, obviously in Scotland, that trend has been bucked slightly, albeit whether or not can weather the potential economic storm still ahead remains to be seen. But obviously, we've actually ended up, employment was broadly protected through the pandemic. Again, there is a big question about the extent to which public sector employment has insulated Scotland somewhat, given, again, it's disproportionately represented within the workforce. However, you know, exactly as you say, and again, Scottish businesses of the four home nations, Scottish businesses are the ones who are least likely to currently face troubles recruiting. But again, the unemployment impact of the pandemic was smaller than in the rest of the UK. As such, there was a much smaller cohort of people who were potentially trying to find new jobs and new jobs in different sectors. As the scale of the problem starts to grow, that cohort of people starts to grow. And it's not, again, it's not entirely clear if structurally the economy is set up to be able to support those people into new and different sectors or technologies. But no doubt the Toms will have something from UK.
Yeah, I think the only thing I'd add is the bank's forecast, obviously it is just a forecast, but the bank's forecast is for unemployment to grow and to keep growing until the end of 2025, 3 years away, which could mean for some people really quite long-term periods of of unemployment. And that's where we tend to worry more about long-term periods of unemployment. That's where your skills atrophy, and you're not building up your human capital whilst working, and so that can have kind of more longer-term consequences. for people's labour market prospects. Whereas if it's just short-term period of unemployment, it's not great, obviously, but doesn't necessarily have such longer-term effects. So that's I think that would be as much as well as the actual rise in unemployment itself. The length of the time of having an elevated unemployment rate, I think, is probably just as concerning, something to worry about.
Can I just bring in Alex Rowley on this point, and then I will get back to you, John.
Sorry, John. just to pick up on that point, because in a sense we're looking at this as labour market and activity linked to COVID, and we may be making big leaps about assumptions that somehow the pandemic has led to this, when actually you talked about skills and training there, you talked about other factors, the welfare system, the lack of support, etc. So in your opinion, what impact, if any, did COVID-19 pandemic leave or have on the levels of economic inactivity? I mean, are we sort of barking up the wrong tree here, or what?
No, I absolutely don't think so. And it's a really tricky one, because you do not want to... Everyone in the country, everyone in the world was impacted by the pandemic. You absolutely do not want to make light of it or make it seem like it did not have really severe and significant impacts, in particular for countless people who may have lost their jobs, who, you know, their health deteriorated, who are now suffering from long COVID. So you absolutely need to ensure that that is the forefront of your mind and how you protect and support those people. But what you also, I think there has potentially been a tendency from governments all over to start to frame what were long-standing issues through a lens of COVID. So waiting lists, unemployment, economic output. There is a tendency to frame that as, you know, in the aftermath of the pandemic, as we recover from the pandemic. That is right. But it cannot ignore the fact that in a large number of instances, these were long-standing issues. So again, health inequalities. We know that health inequalities in Scotland have been severe, you know, particularly amongst our most deprived communities. They have not gone away. Again, the pandemic may have exacerbated them, but they still exist. You know, we know that, are we setting ourselves up for the jobs of the future, for the industries of the future? Again, COVID impacted on some sectors, but that long-term economic planning should have been happening well before the pandemic hit, because I think it was always clear that certain sectors were always going to see a decline and have seen a decline over the last number of years, well before the pandemic. So I don't think that you're barking up the wrong tree, but I do think it's absolutely vital that, as well as recognising that there are specific impacts as a result of COVID, that actually in a large number of instances, these are long-standing trends, which, you know, no matter what you do in response to COVID, need to be addressed as long-standing trends.
Yeah, thank you.
Mason, we have time.
That's okay. I really just have one other point, I think, but it's on that general point and tied back to what you said earlier, because this idea of long-term trends, and I mean, one of these might be that people are going in, doing less retail in town and city centres, and maybe less socialising as well. Now, clearly, that's altogether stopped when COVID happened, and then there's been a kind of gradual drift back. So I'm just wondering, where do you think we are in that process? I mean, are we, is what we've got now, especially in city centres I'm thinking of, if what we've got now is what's going to continue, or do we need to wait a bit longer to see, will people go back to work in the offices in the winter when it's cold, all that kind of thing?
I am definitely not a futurologist, but I don't think anyone wants to be. After the last few years, anyone trying to predict the future is probably barking up the wrong tree. It's difficult to draw any firm conclusions. You know, lots of businesses have responded differently. I would be surprised if what you see now is not broadly, well, it's a settled state, but only in the world we live in. So, you know, high streets are in decline because, you know, you cannot divorce that from the fact that housing developments have moved out of town, because that's where land for house building is, or at least that's where it's been prioritised and invested in. So that's got as much of an impact on the decline of high streets than the pandemic causing lockdown has had, you know, even before the pandemic. So I think, again, it's trying to recognise that the pandemic has accelerated some trends, but actually, again, the way that we have structured our economy means that they were always at risk of happening. So you cannot have a vibrant high street if you do not have a vibrant community that exists around about it. You know,
people deliberately went into the city centres to shop, cinema, restaurant.
There's a, yeah. They did, but you, in terms of, but where you've started to see development, you know, we know that high streets are in decline, so they are. And again, that has been partly as a response to people shifting. So it could be that, you know, cinemas, you know, obviously during lockdown, lots of the films started to appear online, you know, before, while appearing in cinemas. Does that trend continue? I don't know, and I definitely don't want to predict, but all I do know is that COVID certainly accelerated and impacted on things like that. But again, they have been trends that we started to witness well before the pandemic.
Okay, I mean, finally, Tom Waters, I saw you smiled at one point. Maybe you are a futurologist, I don't know, but do you think we are where we're going to be, or do you think things could change quite a lot, especially towns and city centres?
No, I liked Philip's response. I'm not, definitely not a futurologist either. Cast my mind back a little bit now, we did actually see kind of spending, consumer spending kind of plateau quite early on in the pandemic. Obviously, it fell massively and during the first lockdown, then it rebounded, and then it sort of plateaued at kind of below its pre-pandemic level. It's still below its pre-pandemic level. And so I guess that gives some indication that things might not bounce back much further. Obviously, it's very difficult to disentangle that from now, you know, we've got high inflation and cost of living crisis having its own impact. So, disentangling all of those things would be, certainly very, very difficult. So I certainly wouldn't want to make any firm predictions.
Okay, thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Camilla. Phil, I'm going to go back to something you said earlier on. I have a feeling this might be controversial. So, we've talked about economic inactivity, and there are certain areas of inactivity. And I think probably before we started, our conclusion was that the inactivity was across all levels, but it looks to be, you know, if we're talking about inactivity, people are just getting out of the workforce. And they're not working, so they're retiring, stopping working altogether. They must be able to afford to be able to not work if they're getting out of the workforce. And there's a suggestion from yourself and from the evidence session last week where we shouldn't be bothering to pursue those folk. But do we know that the people who are just saying, I don't want to work, can actually afford not to?
And so again, like, there's a question. So again, it's where you start to try and put together data sets. And as I said earlier, all you can do is, to an extent for now, until the data starts to come through to show the impacts of that, all you can start to do is start to infer some kind of causal link. So again, pointed to the UNS survey that finds that, you know, whilst people are retiring, actually they're not confident that they've got the kind of financial means to be able to sustain that. So again, people may have retired well before the current cost of living and inflation crisis hit. Maybe that starts to change people's minds, that they realise that, you know, the small amount of savings that they'd set aside absolutely will not see them through. So it's really difficult to tell where those people have gone. Equally, I think the thing that we've not kind of covered off is primary versus secondary reasons. And again, it's impossible to know yet with the data that we have. So there is about 4 in 10 of people who become inactive for a reason other than long-term sickness. They still have a long-term condition. So again, there's that kind of interdependency of, it could well be that someone chose to retire or become inactive for another reason. And that was their primary driver. But again, you know, potentially this is all anecdotal and kind of, again, we don't have the evidence. It may be that they had been working with a long-term condition, you know, up until the pandemic. And the pandemic was just that switch that said, you know what, I've been kind of struggling through, I've got a long-term condition, but actually this has made me realise that now is the time to retire. So they retire, and their primary reason could be retirement, but secondary, but, you know, a long-term condition has still played a factor. So again, there's just all these variables that we're still unable to kind of really get to the root of so far. But over and above that, like, I would go back, and I absolutely don't take it as they've gone, they're never coming back, give up, because there will be some who do want to come back. You know, we know that how we view age in society still is not great by any means.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I'm sitting looking at a bit here from, I think it's, Public Health Scotland's submission. Early evidence from the Glasgow City Region Intelligence Hub suggests the increase in retirement is due to lifestyle choices, ageist recruitment practices, changes in working practices, socialising in the workplace, so we go back to home working, was an element that kept people in work, and due to the rise of home working, people have decided to leave the labour market. So your ageism, getting away from that, socialising in the workplace. Do we need to have a rethink on that ability for people to stay at home, or the requirement for people to stay at home while they're working?
Yeah, and I mean, again, it's impossible to do a one-size-fits-all model, isn't it? But I think it's where you come back to, you know, so again, the social model of disability says that disabled people face barriers not because of their disability, but because of the barriers that people put up in response to that. You can start to, you know, you can spread that out to wider factors, age included, that actually age is not the thing stopping people being really successful in the workforce. What is are employers and others who, you know, still continue to view that as a limiting factor, or at least certainly a you know, unattractive factor where compared to a much younger worker going for the same job. So there's absolutely, I think, you know, Tom said this earlier, that it's not that you give up on them, it's not that you say that they've gone, so they're gone forever, but it's also not that you necessarily have to try and get them back in. What you do need to do is fundamentally shift your employment practices, your kind of structural or societal view, to ensure that they have the means and the ability to come back in if they want to. And I think particularly amongst the inactive population, that is the key thing. It is if they want to, because we know that so many of them disengage that they may not want to ever.
Thank you. Tom Waters, I think it is. Sorry, I've got the wrong glasses on, so I can't see at distance. I'm going some of the stats that came back and that were in your submission. Long COVID is increasing the number of people in work but on sick, and it'll lead to reduced hours. Do we know economically what impact that is going to have with people who are still regarded as employed but they're not actually working to the same extent or at all because of long COVID?
Yeah, I might just pass over to the other Tom on the economic on the economic impact of it. I know he'll have that number in mind.
So in terms of the total impact on lost earnings, it's going to be about $1.5 billion per year, or £1,100 per month per worker affected. There's also going to be a knock-on cost for employers who are having to pay sick pay, and of course a smaller knock-on fiscal impact as well with lost tax revenues. I think that the overall magnitude of the total economic impact isn't an enormous one, especially in terms of fiscal revenues and so on. It's the main concern here is the sort of individual impact on those who do have to go off sick. So it's not like this is a massive chunk of people in terms of the overall context, the size of the workforce, although it is, of course, something that matters still. I think that the main concern in many ways is the individual impact.
Okay. We know that the Scottish workforce is ageing more rapidly than the rest of the UK, and that could be a contributing factor to historically higher levels of inactivity in the Scottish workforce. And we're talking about, you know, why people are retiring, given the fact that there's more of them seem to be retiring now. Is there a risk that the pandemic will have a disproportionate effect on our workforce here in Scotland? Either of the Toms.
The way I think about kind of the long-term impacts of the pandemic, you've got one of the things we've been talking about is retirement, inactivity. But then you also have what's the impact going to be kind of on long-term productivity. We've had this, you know, this period of kind of immense disruption, businesses closing down and so on. And that, I don't know, perhaps Philip will know some of the Scotland specific numbers, but my my sense is that those kinds of effects can be at least as big as the number of, as the impact on the number of people working. So, I mean, the OBR think that, you know, that the UK has become permanently poorer because of COVID, that our long-run GDP is a couple of percent lower or something, and that's because of these sorts of effects, this huge amount of disruption, business shutting down, that has kind of long-run consequences for productivity and for the economy. And so, yeah, my sense would be the difference between that in Scotland and the rest of the UK could be important. But I don't know whether Philip has anything Scotland specific he could feed in on that.
I suppose just to make clear that there was a downward trend of inactivity as a result of retirement in Scotland up until the pandemic. The pandemic saw a small uptick, so in Scotland, downward trend till the pandemic, small uptick through the pandemic. But then the most recent stats have, again, that downward trend kicking back in. So it was that bit in the pandemic that you saw retirement as a reason, as a proportion of inactivity going in the wrong direction. Again, in Scotland, actually the main driver in particular has been around ill health. So again, I do not want to make it seem as though I'm kind of saying, well, they've retired, they've gone, we don't need to worry about the older people, because I'm absolutely not, I promise. But I think the trend has been slightly different in Scotland as compared to the rest of the UK.
Right, okay. Very last question. I'm going to ask you the same question as I asked the previous panel. Are we asking you as a panel the right questions to get what it is that we are trying to find out in the first place? I'll go to you first, Phil.
That's a good question. Goodness, you don't want to get invited to committee and tell them how to do your job.
No, but...
convener, cover your ears. I go back to what I said earlier. The pandemic has specific impacts. It has exacerbated some conditions. It has exacerbated some outcomes for people. But I think there is a risk of viewing this issue primarily through or solely through that prism. These are long-standing trends. I think perhaps what hasn't come out enough, it has come out, I've kind of looked over last week's evidence session, but is the relationship between health and prosperity, which again we know are incredibly closely linked. So actually there is absolutely a question about what we do to restructure the economy. You know, we've seen stagnating wage growth, we've seen the rise in precarious jobs, jobs with less hours paying less money. There are structural issues that can cause people to drop out of the economy. We need to address that. We need to address ensuring we've got a skilled workforce coming through. We need to address the scale of employability support that we have in Scotland. On the flip side of that, obviously the health system goes hand in hand. And I think being able to view those two things as more closely related than we perhaps have, like we know again, goodness, it is 10 years since Christie Commission, more than 10 years since Christie Commission. So I dread to still continue to talk about prevention, but we're not there yet. We need to see a big shift on prevention and the role that the health service plays in that. And being able to start to address the long-term conditions that we know are having an impact on inactivity and vice versa. So I think that's maybe the bit that focus needs to be put on, is kind of the role of the health system in shaping economic prosperity, and importantly vice versa, because we know that economic prosperity and health outcomes are very closely related.
Thank you. Either of the Toms, you want to add anything before we move on?
I think maybe the only thing I'd say is one thing I think you might want to know the answer to would be we talked a little bit, we touched on a little bit earlier, I think Philip mentioned earlier, the kind of support that people get back into work, you know, what kind of support do you get at the job centre? And there have been a couple of government programmes, Restart and Kickstart, to try and improve this since COVID. But insofar as the problems relate, insofar as the increasing activity is about older workers, those, you know, the kind of support that you need to get back into work if you're an older worker is potentially pretty different to if you're a younger worker. You know, the Kickstart scheme, I think, is supposed to think only at those under age 25, for example. And I think thinking about what kinds of programs have worked for older workers, perhaps in other countries, are there some sort of small pilots or experiments that could be run in Scotland? Those sorts of things might be quite valuable for helping people who do want to get back into work, but to do so. So, that would be one thing I think to think about going forward.
other
thoughts? Yeah, I think in terms of, is there anything else you should be asking? Maybe specifically on the cause of activity, I'm not sure, but in terms of just other matters to do with the labour market and the impact of the pandemic, I suppose also the questions of ongoing productivity and has that been affected, as we mentioned earlier, in terms of people, are more people working from home and is that having an impact? And also just an awareness that many of the impacts of the pandemic, this is relating to the point earlier, are we barking up the wrong tree? Many of them might actually take much longer than we've had so far to materialise if we're worried about, a disruption to education or whether people's dropping out of work during the pandemic has damaged their human capital and their productivity long term, that kind of thing. We might not be able to observe it yet. So I think just keeping an eye on this for the much longer term will be very important. And it may or may not be the case that the pandemic has a bigger effect down the line than it has had right now in terms of the impact on the economy.
Thank you very much.
And I'm just going to bring in Alex Rowley. Just one
very question. Quickly, Philip, you mentioned Christie. I mean, my view is that progress on Christie has been woeful. But has there been any research done to look at, because we certainly have not got to a position where we're able to shift to and health in particular, but has there been research done to look at what progress has been made and why it is so?
Some stuff kind of Christie 10 years on, but I'm not sure how in depth it got. And it is difficult because there is within a fixed budget in particular, there's a trade-off of the more money you put into prevention, does that mean less money for treatment? But it's very clear that we need to see a shift on those. So for a bit of work that we did recently, I was kind of looking at this. So, you know, again, we know that the incidences of cancer, of obesity, of cardiovascular disease are all far higher in deprived communities than they are in non-deprived communities. So as such, there's preventative stuff that needs to happen. That requires funding, that requires a specific focus on deprivation, but then that equally follows through into treatment in terms of early diagnosis and screening. And we have both of those things to an extent. You know, we have action to try and stop smoking and to promote healthier lifestyles. We've started seeing, in particular, as a result of the pandemic, more action on early diagnosis, particularly around cancer, with the establishment of the early diagnostic centres. What I think, again, you're still missing in both of those, you can look through, you know, it's not a scientific way to do it, but do a control F of kind of various strategies on cancer, on obesity, etc. You do a control F for deprivation, and other than kind of, you know, a sentence that says people in deprived communities are more at risk of these diseases and illnesses, what you don't have is then any specific actions which, you know, specifically target those communities, again, either in terms of prevention or treatment. So I think, again, that is the thing that we potentially miss. We know where the higher incidences and risk factors are, but quite often, again, potentially because of that, if you've got a limited pot of money, where do you put it? And if you're trying to spread it across prevention and treatment, you're probably wanting to spread it across everyone. But it feels that, again, we've done lots of research on, again, the link between health and prosperity. If you want to really start to address, in particular, regional inequalities, you need to get right to the heart of the issues that deprivation causes and within health. I think, you know, again, I'm not a health expert, but that needs to come with a specific focus in the health system and in funding, diagnosis, treatment, prevention on those communities, which, again, I just don't think we have seen to date.
Thank you. Thank you, Kendra.
Okay. Thank you very much. And I thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing and the clerks will be happy to liaise on how you do that. We intend to continue this evidence in November before we hear from the Scottish Government on our meeting on the 8th of December. The committee's next meeting will be on the 17th of November when we will continue our inquiry by looking at early retirement as a driver of economic inactivity in more detail. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and the meeting to go into private. Thank you.